I went from New Kids on the Block, Paula Abdul, then I went to Bobby Brown, then I got really big into New Jack Swing mm-hmm. in like grade 7, and then you know, Boys to Men, yeah. Bill Biv DeVoe, that kind of stuff, and I wore a lot of silk. and only hung out with other Italian people.
Okay.
So I had a very narrow worldview, and yeah. that worldview was very polka dot at that time.
Welcome to This Broken Mixtape, the podcast that rewinds and presses play on the soundtrack to your life. I'm Jeff Wu.
And I'm Justin Lee.
For over a decade, self-proclaimed not-so-successful to moderately successful band Teenanger has been a mainstay of Toronto's post-punk scene. With 5 albums under their belt, the 4-piece's latest record, Teenager, is a tongue-in-cheek reference to the band's commonly misread name. We sat down with Teenanger's Chris Swimming and Steve Sidoli to talk about how their serendipitous run-in One Drunken Night led to the band's formation, favorite celebrity pasta sauces courtesy of Marky, Ramone and Paul Newman, and various Toronto-themed song titles for their fictitious Blur cover band.
This week, our special guest is Chris Swimming and Steve Sidoli of Teenanger. Welcome to the show, guys.
Thanks for having us.
So, I don't know, who runs the Twitter account? Is it you, Chris?
Mainly me, yes.
Okay. You recently tweeted out on New Year's you did acid, and then
correct.
The day after, you said, maybe my New Year's resolution is to never do acid in the city again.
Yeah.
Tell us what happened there.
I did a quarter tab of acid, and then the rest of the people in my party were on a rival drug, opposing drug, more uptown. Mm-hmm. And we arrived at this New Year's party, and it was just way too overwhelming for me, and there was too many acquaintances, and I was just like freaked out. So then I ended up walking home with my friend Neil through the back alleys from Bloor and Lansdowne all the way to Beaconsfield and Argyle. Mm-hmm. And then I received a call from my wife's best friend that my wife had fainted and split her head open on the curb.
No.
Oh, wow.
And
I was not equipped to do it.
And then after that, it was just mental gymnastics like the rest of the evening.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I've never tried acid. I've heard a lot from a good friend of mine. And what kind of, are there hallucinations involved? Is it?
Yeah, I'd say, for me personally, I've always just eased my way up into it. I've never gone like full tab.
Right.
But usually it's just like slight hallucinations, mostly like euphoric, and like you're in control most of the time. But if you have any sort of negative thought and latch onto it, then it's game over.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Snow looks pretty good on it.
Absolutely. The CN Tower was actually looking quite crazy.
Yeah, right? What did it look like?
It looked like, I don't know, like My Pet Monster or something like that.
Wow.
I was really seeing
classic
that.
My Pet Monster.
I think they should administer LSD to every Canadian because it's the only way that you can properly appreciate the beauty of snow.
Absolutely.
You would enjoy shoveling your snow a lot more if you were on acid all the time.
Well, microdosing seems to be a big thing now, right?
Tried it.
Yeah, I've been hearing like that.
Yeah.
There's a lot of great creative effects, impacts of microdosing. So
our friend who we were hanging out with earlier in the evening on New Year's Eve, she lives in Berkeley, California now, and she calls it, I guess in California they refer to it as microwing.
Okay.
Which is like, all right, another abbreviation. That's good.
Yeah, for me, microwing is like microblading. That's like when you actually like pluck your eyebrows a certain way to make them look really good. I'm more of a macro doser myself. Go big or go home.
Well, with songs like Alone on Acid, MDMA Jam, and Emoji Kush, drugs seem to be not a huge component, but a small component of the band, if that's fair.
That's totally fair.
How much of a role, if at all, would you say they have in terms of creative inspiration, in terms of the music?
Would you say largely, Steve?
From my end, it's not a huge amount, but I like, when I think of our music, I like to think of like a guy with a shaved head in like 1998 with like really baggy pants and like a few different drugs in like different packets. And he's like going to a party and trying to figure out where he's going to go that night, you know, what he's going to choose. So I think that it's in our imagery, but it's maybe not in my ingestion, if that makes any sense. But that's just me.
Yeah, largely for me in the creative process, but live, I don't like to ever combine those things.
Yeah, yeah.
But I did do that once in Lawrence, Kansas, and there was only four people in the show.
Okay.
But even with those four people, I was still terrified of the audience.
Well, the four people were the other band. They're from the Netherlands.
And they were very tall.
We said the singer looked like a California skeleton.
If you're the drummer and you're kind of behind everyone else, that would helps. Be the best place, right?
That helps. To do it. Yeah, I do. But I feel like I'm just frantically trying to just play these beats and keep them together. And you know, with other instruments, they're stopping most of the time. Sure. You can move, but like I'm just sitting there. Sometimes I feel like I'm just like a machine playing beats, and you know, you put something else into the equation, something that changes your mental perspective a little bit, and then, you know, it becomes a lot less like playing music and a lot more like playing like Burger Time on Atari or something.
Nice.
You just
already
like,
two great 80s references. My Pet Monster and Burger Time. Love it.
The whole thing's going to fall apart. Just take a breath. Don't even breathe.
So you guys have been around for almost a decade. And from the very beginning, people have been calling you Teenager. And now I guess, you know, it's something that you're so used to. Are you sick of hearing that? Is it just, you know, par for the course?
I think I like it more now.
Yeah, same. It used to agitate me, but now I'm just accepting it.
I mean, I never got agitated. I think I got disappointed in people. Because I was like, you know, do your research.
Don't you know how to read?
Take a minute, you know, just like get it right.
Yeah.
You know, people really should just get it right more often, but they never do. But now I think I've just made peace with the fact that the human mind often makes mistakes. And we created a band name that's a play on words that's really hard to miss. Or sorry, really easy to miss. So really, really hard not to mess up.
Yeah.
So I'm okay with it now. Yeah, I've forgiven everyone.
The N is silent in the Teenager.
I mean, I will put forth that if I was not in the band, there is a possibility that at some point in my life, I may have made that exact same mistake.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's one of those, like, if you just look at it really carefully, or not carefully, and just... like, oh, Teenager. But,
exactly.
Yeah, I heard it while I was waiting in line at the send-off Parts and Labor show.
Ah, yes. Yeah. I think I also did.
Yeah.
Yeah, that so was on I the ran around the corner, vomited profusely a few times, and then came back and made peace with it.
Speaking of which, the Parts of Labor show, just a wild show. You guys played with Mets. Tell us about that show and how you think it went. And, you know, as much detail as possible.
Well, we still haven't been paid for it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. And, you know, it's the Parts and Labor is now closed, so are you guys going to be paid for it?
I don't know. I'm going to follow up with him gently tomorrow.
Yeah.
We should call them right now.
Yeah.
Or get him on the horn.
Yeah. What's the number for 911? We'll get paid.
We'll get paid.
Yeah. I have my ways.
Well, one of the things about that show was the for anyone who hasn't been to the shop, like in the basement of the Parts and Labor, the ceiling is what would you say like 7 feet?
Yeah, I'd say seven. Like yeah. Seven's about right.
So the very fact that people are moshing, crowd surfing is insane because it's. I mean, I don't want to sound like an old guy here, but like insanely dangerous, right?
Right.
I just kept seeing these people who their faces were like this close to the ceiling. I'm like, you're going to get hurt, man.
Yeah, we call that the Parkdale nose job. Right? Got any kind of like, you know, discrepancy around the bridge of the nose, anything that kind of stands out or whatever, you just mosh a few times, get up there, and then it just scrapes it right off. So you're looking, it's like Botox, instant Botox.
And then the other thing is that the ceiling itself was just kind of coming apart. There was already like a bit of a hole. And, you know, I kind of called you out on Instagram.
I'm sorry. I spit venom back at you. Pit viper. No, it's totally cool.
Yeah, but you know, I didn't stay for all of Mets. I stayed for about three quarters. By the end, was there like a significant hole in the ceiling?
I think there was a significant hole in everyone's lungs from breathing in the asbestos or whatever is in that
drywall dust.
That drywall dust, gypsum dust.
Yeah,
silicosis.
Did you know that that's what it's made of? Gypsum. So
gypsum.
Okay. Yeah, people who work in the industry call it gyp rock.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a term that they used to use. And they probably still use.
Was it in the drywall biz?
Son of a drywaller.
Yeah.
It's like a son of a preacher man, son of a drywaller.
dusty Springfield.
Anyways, but yes, holes in the lungs. It was like it was really dusty, dangerous, and a good send off to the shop.
Yeah, absolutely. Great show. Getting back to teen anger. Mm-hmm. How angsty were you guys as teenagers on a scale of Hoobastank to Fugazi?
Oh, Fugazi being the least angsty, or
I would say the most. I mean, between those two, like
very Fugazi.
Okay,
I definitely owned Red Medicine on CD from HMV, and
I also owned it. However, I probably looked more like I should have been in Hoobastank. It's like one of those memes, right? Where it's like what you think you look like and what you look like, right? So I thought I was the cool guy with the fedora from like 1920s who had like a machine gun in his bag, but I actually was the guy playing magic cards in Oshawa.
So okay, like let's take it back to like when you guys first were listening to music just around the house. What were your parents playing? Let's start with you, Steve.
Oh, big time La Bamba soundtrack.
Okay.
Yeah. Richie.
Richie.
Great ending.
Yeah. Dirty Dancing soundtrack was a big one.
Yeah.
Umberto Tozzi, the Italian singer, he was the person who originally did Gloria, which was made popular in America by a singer whose name I do not know. However, it would be cool if that person's name was also Gloria. But those were the big ones. Oh, and also the soundtrack to Every Woman in the 1980s, which was Carly Simon. Ooh, I can't remember the name of it, but it's her really popular one.
Why?
No, it's post Why. It's Carly Simon. Anyways. We'll figure that out. Fix it in post.
How about you, Chris?
Leave it in.
Okay. My parents listened to, I grew up a lot listening to Tears for Fears.
Nice.
And, Sade and Modern Jazz Quartet. Like a lot of vibraphone going on. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what my parents really dug. And they like Simply Red a lot as well.
Okay.
Yeah. Pretty 80s.
Coming Back Again. Carly Simon Coming Back Again was the name of that record, I believe.
There we go.
And then, do you guys remember the first CD that you bought with your own money? Or
absolutely, it was Cypress Hill, Temples of Boom.
Nice.
Mine was the second Paula Abdul record.
Nice.
I'm sorry.
It wasn't even the first one. It wasn't even the one with the big hits.
It was the one with Cold Hearted Snake.
It wasn't that one. It was the one with Rush. Which had the video featuring Emilio Estevez. Yes.
No, Keanu Reeves.
Keanu Reeves, yeah.
Yes.
Featuring Keanu Reeves, who is the poor man's Emilio Estevez.
Free Jack, baby.
And then from there, I mean, I think like for a lot of people, it's just kind of based on whatever they hear from their friends. Take us through your sort of musical journey through teenagedom to early adulthood.
For me personally, I started off with, I went from New Kids on the Block, Paula Abdul, then I went to Bobby Brown, then I got really big into New Jack Swing in like grade 7, and then, Boys to Men, Bill Biv DeVoe, that kind of stuff, and I wore a lot of silk Only hung out with other Italian people.
Okay.
So I had a very narrow worldview, and that worldview was very polka dot at that time. and then I started, I got into high school, bigger school, started hanging out with more like WASPy kids, and I kind of gave up those roots and got into, I bought an AC/DC CD, and I was just like, you know, AC/DC, FTW, this is what the real people, the real smart people listen to, you know? I was like, I'm so edgy with this AC/DC tape. And then it went to, then somehow I landed with a Doughboys tape, pop punk band from Canada.
Yeah.
And that was like Montreal. The first moment that like things really clicked. I really liked it. Mm-hmm. And then it kind of like just spiraled from there. I started going to punk shows and, you know, grades went down, started smoking cigarettes, stopped smoking cigarettes, started smoking cigarettes again, went on one date, graduated.
How about you, Chris?
I guess it started in my first like real interest in music was like seventh grade. I like loved the Beastie Boys and like Wu-Tang, Cypress Hill, like a lot of hip hop. And then I discovered like SoCal skate punk, all that Fat Records Epitaph kind of stuff. Sure. And then when I was in ninth grade, I got my first real test of like the DIY punk scene. And it was actually seeing Steve's old high school band, Frodo, at the Elmont Community Center just west of Ottawa.
He's not lying.
And
it's that much of an age gap between us.
And Steve's band had a song entitled Lucien Can't Call Bingo for Shit, which I believe was about his mother going to bingo and being unsatisfied with this one teller.
Yeah, her theory was that the reason that she wasn't winning when playing bingo was because the teller was either A, incompetent, or B, was like rigging the game specifically so that she wouldn't win. So his name was Lucien. Okay. So obviously Lucien can't call bingo for shit.
And then when I was 19, I had this girlfriend and she made me this mix CDR, like from the CD burner. Mm-hmm. And it had like The Fall, Captain Beefheart, Can, and like a bunch of other bands. And I never heard any of them before. And it all like blew my mind. So shout out to Marnie if you're listening.
Marnie.
Well, that sounds like an amazing mix CD. How about you, Steve? Were you ever gifted an interesting mix CD?
I made a few.
Mixtape, yeah.
I made a few, and then I made the mistake of putting my return address on the envelopes, and so they just came right back.
Wait, who are you sending these to? Just crushes?
I can't legally tell you John who I was Peel. Sending those to.
He was still alive.
No, I never was really given any. Oh, actually, that's not true. The same band that Chris was just talking about, Frodo. Mm-hmm. I was the singer and the guitar player of that band, and I was not very good at either of those things. So at one point, I got this idea in my head that if I were to find a lead singer for the band, then I would be able to concentrate on playing guitar, and I wouldn't suck as bad, right? And the band would be better. But there were so many other problems that none of it was fixable, and we should have just went with like our ramshackle teenage kind of like crappiness. But instead, we forged on with this this search for the new singer, and we found a guy, and I cannot remember his name for the life of me. But I had his name and his number on a post-it note. And I think it might have been James, actually. And he had 9 fingers, right? So anybody who follows Lord of the Rings knows that Frodo at one point gets 9 fingers, right? Was it Frodo or Bilbo? I can't remember. But somebody gets a finger lopped off. So I was like, 16-year-old me was like, this is meant to be, right? This is the story that I'll be telling whoever was popular at the time, Jerry Springer on like network TV, right? But what I didn't realize was that the, let's call him James, the lead singer prospect, was actually 28 years old.
What? Like he just looked like a kid?
No, he did not. He looked like a full-grown man, but you know.
Whatever James is at nowadays.
He had a goatee. But, you know, I had pointy sideburns, too. They just hadn't grown in fully yet at that point. So so he made me a CD, and it was unlabeled. And I don't know still to this day what was on it, but I believe it was a lot of like the emo core stuff that was popular at the time. Texas is the Reason, this kind of thing, right? And I loved that tape. But I think what I loved most about it was the fact that I didn't know any of the bands or song titles. Mm-hmm. So it was just like this mysterious thing that sounded different than anything else I'd ever heard. Mm-hmm. And every singer had such a high voice, like a high angelic voice. So I thought it was like this heavenly tape.
You should like Shazam it.
You still don't have the tape anymore, though. Yeah. I mean, in a perfect world, that would be a great ending to the story.
Yeah.
However, the tape is probably rotting at the bottom of some kind of landfill.
Chris, do you still have that mix CD?
I think I do at my parents' place in like a forever box that they've like kept all my stuff in.
Now, that would have been a great idea.
Yeah.
If I would have had one of those.
A forever box?
Yeah. You should bury the forever box, turn it into a time capsule.
I plan to be buried with it.
Okay, nice. It's a different type of time capsule. Yeah. Sarcophagus.
All my Jostens photos.
Jostens photos.
So many great references. I haven't heard that name in years. No. So let's fast forward here. And when did you guys finally meet and start the band?
I was 20 at the time. Steve was 25. I was like, whoa, this guy is older.
24 and a bit.
24 and change. But we were walking home from a bar together, and he was like, he had the hiccups, and that's one thing I focused on. And Steve's like, I got this studio. It's called Transient Audio.
Transient Audio.
Transient Audio. I'm trying to like, I'm modeling it after like Inner Ear Studios in Washington, D.C. You know Inner Ear, where like Ian MacKay records? I was like, sounds cool, man. And then we went back to his place, and I saw the room, and we smoked a joint.
And then it was not long after that that... we were hanging out fairly regularly, and I once came home from the bar, ate half of a vanilla cake, went to bed, woke up, rolled over, vomited out the cake. The cake had not, it was like regurgitated perfect vanilla cake. It came out exactly the same as it looked going in, like nothing had even happened.
It's like bird food.
I don't even know how to respond to that.
It just shows you what kind of crazy life we were living back in the day.
Too bad there wasn't like a nest on the floor with chicks you get fed.
Yeah, I was like 1 week of non-cleaning away from having a nest on the floor with chicks. Yeah.
So on your song, Cops But Not, you guys recount a time when you were chased by a security cop in Hyde Park. Can you tell us about that experience?
Yeah, it was myself and like four other friends of mine. We were just a bunch of grown men on psychedelic drugs running through Hyde Park. And then we did encounter cops like three times. And then another time we would see like just like normal bystanders. And we'd just be like, oh, no, cops. Not cops. And then somehow I like did the phrasing into the chorus.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the people present in that party is the owner of a indie coffee chain in which he urinated on a couple in a baseball diamond. And then the boyfriend got up because they were on the ground and was like, yo, get back. Yo, I'll clap you, dog. I'm gonna clap you, dog. And they were just like running into the forest. Like
he didn't know that they were there, though.
He didn't know they were there. Just like, it was like a dark mound to him.
I right.
But yeah.
One like, of those... Piss hills.
One of those piss hills.
Isn't that like the Toronto municipal government puts those around, you know, just like these little piss mounds?
Mm-hmm.
I've never heard that phrasing before.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know it if I saw it.
These are the things that the Ford government doesn't want you to know. That's where our tax money's going, the piss mounds. Human piss mounds. Okay.
Let's talk a little bit about your Tumblr. So, you know, as it stands right now, there seems to be a lot of...
inactivity?
Well, that, but when you guys did update, a lot of reviews of indie video games, as well as some random facts about guinea pigs. Would you say that pretty much sums up your interests and hobbies outside of music?
I mean, it's funny that you mentioned that, because I was just in Best Buy, and I briefly thought about buying one of those mini... PlayStations mm-hmm. that have just come out, the gray ones.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably about the last time I played a video game, but the thing I remember about those was that it took so long to load the games. Yeah. It would be like you would be waiting, and the technology of the game, the graphics was so much better than the Nintendo or anything that came before it, mm-hmm. but you would be sitting there and the thing would be spinning and really noisily too. Mm-hmm. And like certain games was just load, 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 load. The ones with like the crazy graphics.
Yeah.
You just, because I guess they have to load the
like
graphics.
Like Tony Hawk would take forever.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah.
An eternity.
Yeah. The things that like you went through that you don't anymore. Anyway, so that's where I am with video games. What was the other thing?
Oh, guinea pigs.
Oh, yeah. I had no involvement in the Tumblr whatsoever. It was John and Steven. It's very, like, sparsely updated.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we are the guinea pigs. We're the guinea pigs for how long you can keep a not-so-successful to moderately successful band going before people start to, you know, before the accolades start rolling in simply because of our longevity.
Yeah, I mean, it's impressive. It's, you guys are like already, what, 9 years into it and albums.
I think it's 12, more like 12 now.
12 yeah. Okay. Yeah. The first album came out in 2010 though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We put out a couple of EPs prior to that, but they never really...
Cassette EPs.
Mm-hmm. And we did one vinyl. Like,
and so. One vinyl.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but
still does well on Spotify.
Nice.
Never did well on Spotify when it came out because Spotify didn't exist, but now it does well on Spotify.
MP3.com though, when it came.
MP3.com, you know who made a bunch of money off that?
Who?
AM herself, Alanis Morissette.
Whoa.
Really? She was an investor then?
She was an investor. She had a really good financial advisor who was like, "You have made a lot of money off Jagged Little Pill. However, from behind the scenes, invest in mp3.com, this new technology, this .com company, and you will become infinitely more wealthy." And she did.
Good for
and
her.
And she became infinitely more wealthy. And then she sold her stock just as mp3.com became completely redundant.
Wow. Maybe she's psychic.
I think she might be psychic, or maybe she's a time traveler.
The llama whipped her ass.
You know, she she does have, she has a Bali-themed penthouse apartment in Ottawa, right next to the Chateau Laurier.
Okay.
So it's the penthouse, and I once saw the listing, because it was for sale, and that's how I know that like she hasn't updated the decor since like 2001, when it was cool to have like a really Bali themed apartment. So maybe that apartment is a time portal. So she just goes from the future to the past and just makes stock broker changes based on that kind of stuff.
I think you need to write that movie. That sounds awesome.
I think she should be in that movie, because she played God in Dogma. Right, remember that?
Right, yeah.
Maybe her ex-husband Ryan Reynolds should be cast as well.
I mean, you know, we're onto something. Ryan Reynolds used to go into the music world at Rideau Center in Ottawa.
Which is the Ottawa equivalent of the Eaton Center for all you non-Ottawa.
Exactly. It's a little bit smaller and there's more stabbings, but other than that, it's very similar. And you can buy weed out there. I don't think you can do that at the Eaton Center, or you could back in then, those days, 2000s. But he would go in because he would visit Alanis's family out in Orleans. And he would buy all the Ryan Reynolds DVDs that were in the music world, and then he would bring them and give them to his family as gifts. I know, that's because ridiculous. My friend was the manager at that one. So.
Wow. Strange.
You'd think he would just either like own them, what, or like he would give them something that they actually want.
Yeah.
But, actors are strange people.
No, so. I'm just going to buy them all.
And this is back when like he really, I mean, I think at now, some might say that he's kind of a respected actor, you know, in some circles, but
he's back done well then, for
he
himself.
Was really not, you know, he was only in like these shitty, like,
rom-coms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was like one of those, like, handsome comedians.
Right.
You know, and it's never great if you're a comedian to be too handsome.
Sure.
Because people don't take you as seriously as a comedian.
Absolutely.
So, but somehow he's got an action thing going. Yeah. Maybe. I don't know if he was, but he got buff, or he was always buff. Can't remember.
Yeah, I saw him in some trash film recently with like Samuel L. Jackson. It was called like The Assassin's Bodyguard. Yeah. I watched it with my parents.
Yeah.
I had no choice.
Short form, The Ass Body.
Is it true that you guys once did a show of just all Ramones covers?
Twice, in fact.
Nice. Okay.
Once upstairs, once downstairs.
At the Silver Dollar in the Comfort Zone.
Nice, mm-hmm. Nice. So who is your favorite Ramon and why?
Oh, good question. I'm going to have to say Joey because he never hurt anyone. And second, Dee Dee.
It's got to be Marky for me because the man has his own pasta sauce. So
that's a good reason.
Marky. Yeah.
You bottle your own pasta sauce, put a label on it. I don't care what you've done in your life. You are now my favorite of whatever your genre of human being is.
So you must love Paul Newman then. Or is that salad dressing?
Paul Newman is my favorite, yeah. My favorite salad dressing that you can get from a grocery store. They have one flavor and it's called olive oil and vinegar. Mm-hmm. And even though it's seemingly only two ingredients, they've got a little mustard in there.
Okay.
They've probably got some other flavorings and it's really, really good. It's a good one.
I mean, it's been on the market for ages, so it must be good, right?
Yeah, and it goes on sale sometimes too.
It's also killer as well. And I bought a jar like 3 days ago.
Yeah. Really? Okay.
And none of the profits go into the Newman family's pockets. It's all 100% goes to charity. So there you go.
Okay. Mm.
I'm sure that was some kind of tax write-off for him back in the day.
Absolutely.
Good for Paul.
And it's great for his personal brand because he actually put his image on each bottle.
Mm-hmm. So you're prolonging buying, his you're likeness.
Not only are you buying salad dressing, you're also buying the image of Paul Newman.
Cool Hand Luke. Yeah,
like I would have to pay someone to give them an image of me, right? You know, they'd be like running in the opposite direction. And I'd be like, here's $50. Here's a photo of me. Just take it. But like I'm paying him $3 to get something with his image on it. And he's dead right now. So passed away, I should say. Passed away.
He's been passed away for quite a while.
Yeah,
he has.
It was a sad day.
On Instagram, I think about a year ago, you guys posted a description for a mattress at IKEA called Teenanger.
Oh, yeah.
And the description was, I quote, molds to your body, enables you to relax more fully, and gives a softer sleep surface. And you jokingly said that it perfectly described the self-titled album that you guys released last year. But I was also thinking about that, and, you know, I don't know if anyone's ever done it, and I'm sure, like, the legalities would be tricky, but it'd be great to have a Teenanger music video shot at IKEA.
Yeah.
I think.
I
always feel like people dread. I mean, there's two camps. You either like IKEA or like myself. I kind of dread going there.
The Vaughn location is amazing.
Is it? I've never been
there. There's nobody there. That'd be perfect like locale to shoot the video.
Yeah. And I think you could kind of do it now with like, you know, all these mini cameras. You could
easily. You can get around it.
Yeah. Didn't they do a movie at Disney World that wasn't like licensed by Disney? So it'd be the same kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I think that would be a pretty good idea.
Walt Disney's turning in his cryogenic chamber.
Or maybe we do it at Muji and try and make it more like hip, right? Do it downtown. I was just in there today and I was like, this is basically like IKEA.
It is
the cooler IKEA. Yeah. And the people are like, you know, 25% more well-dressed and beautiful than what you see in IKEA. At IKEA, you're setting the bar pretty low. But I think in terms of if we're setting bars, it's like Costco, IKEA, Muji, Harry Rosen,
Holt Renfrew,
Donald Trump.
Where's No Frills on that scale?
Oh my goodness.
No Frills is like, it's on its own kind of like separate thing.
Yeah.
It's on its own trajectory. I mean, it's getting cool too, right?
Yeah. Holler.
Holler.
Yeah.
So that's almost time for us, but I just wanted to mention you guys recently tweeted, obviously it was a joke, but you want to start a local Blur cover band called, local Blur cover band called Blur.
Yes.
As in Blur Street.
Yeah.
And the first cover single would be called Line 2.
Yeah.
I know that you guys were joking, but I think you're on to something here. Can you think of any other Toronto-themed Blur cover titles?
Oh, man. I think most of them have been covered. I was like trying to access the hits, but I was like, I can't put a Toronto twist on these.
I mean, you could do Park Life about Trinity Bellwoods, right? And
High Park Life.
Oh, okay.
Right. Or Parkdale Life.
Yeah, Parkdale.
Oh,
Shout out to Parkdale Life's Instagram account.
Yeah.
What about like, you know, girls and boys could be the Boys and Girls Club. I don't know where there's a Boys and Girls Club. I was thinking actually the YMCA, but maybe there is a Boys and Girls Club. downtown that's notable?
Somebody tweeted or responded, the Universal Grill on DuPont.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
No, I guess
we
failed.
Can you think of any, Jeff? Jeff's a huge Blur fan.
So. Yeah, I can't think of anything. I'm not that creative.
Oh, yeah. Graham Coxwell, like, has the color.
Nice.
That's pretty good.
Damon Albran, I don't know.
Damon Albran, right. People don't actually know Albran is manufactured specifically in Toronto. They do the buds. They don't do the flakes.
Really?
Yeah.
You were just filled with, like, these random facts.
That
crazy.
Was a lie. That one was
a lie. I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot today.
Thanks so much, guys. Do you have any shows coming up that you want to plug?
No, not anytime soon.
Yeah, I know you guys just did a whole bunch of shows right before Christmas. Well, before and after. Yeah. But yeah.
No, we're just trying to focus on recording and writing new songs.
Okay, nice. Yeah. So will there be an album later on this year? Or
we're hoping to get an album out, hopefully, by sometime in 2020.
Okay. God willing. Mm-hmm.
Might not make it out by 2019, but 2020, okay. Two things are going to happen. American election, Teenanger album.
Okay. Well, we look forward to it. Thank you so much for being on the show, guys.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks. You've been listening to Season 3, Episode 2 of This Broken Mixtape with Chris Swimming and Steve Sidoli of the Toronto post-punk band Teenanger. If you haven't already, visit thisbrokenmixtape.com to check out this episode's Spotify playlist. There you'll also find all of our past interviews and custom illustrations for each show. If you enjoyed this episode, please take the time to subscribe, rate, and share our podcast however you're tuning into us today. Also, if you have any comments, feedback, or ideas for guests, feel free to drop us a line through our website, Instagram, or Twitter. You can find all our episodes on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, YouTube, and Spotify. As always, thank you for listening. We really appreciate it. Cheers.